Trainee, currently in GKNM Hospital, Coimbatore, and over to Dr. Srinivasan.
Thank you, Chairperson. Good afternoon, everyone. I congratulate, first of all, the organizers for arranging this excellent meeting. My topic today is diabetes co-formulation and what is their role. We've been hearing about, insulin, GLP-1 analog, DPP-4 inhibitors, and SGLT-2 inhibitors a lot. And would they all be able to be combined and given? And is there any evidence? And what is their role in diabetes management is a topic today for me. As you know, diabetes is growing up in epidemic proportion all over the world, and India has second largest population of diabetics, and we have to have an effective means to control glycemic control for these patients. This landmark Chennai urban rural epidemiology study from Morgan Group has suggested that half of the patients with diabetes were not diagnosed. In the half who were diagnosed, only half of them were treated. In the half who were treated, only half of them had a good blood sugar control. That is, about only 40% of people who had diabetes had a good blood sugar control. Why do we have a poor control? It is partly because of compliance. There was a study in UK where in a patient with a chronic disease, even though the medicines were given free to the patients, the compliance of the medication was very poor. There was only about 40 to 50%. And adherence and persistence to the suggested therapy due to hyperglycemia and weight gain are also a problem in achieving a good blood sugar control. As we know, diabetes is a progressive multifactorial cardiometabolic disorder and with multiple pathophysiological abnormalities. We have a lot of agents which cover one or two pathophysiological abnormalities in diabetes. So why not combine ADA and ASD? EASD has recommended that initial combination therapy should be considered in patients who have a baseline HbA1c of more than 9%. Combination agents, when used, should be targeting different pathophysiological abnormalities and should be synergistic and more effective. The dictionary says co-formulation as an act of packaging more than one drug into one pill. So we are all familiar with fixed dose combinations. We have two drug, we have three drug combined together in our practice, and it is well accepted part of diabetes care recently. What should be the ideal co-formulation in type 2 diabetes patients? It should preserve or improve the pancreatic beta cell function, reduce the insulin resistance in muscle and liver, have a beneficial effect on the cardiovascular risk. It should be weight neutral, and it should cause minimal hyperglycemia and should be safe to use. You would be familiar with these two characters in age-old film. They act act together to control the villain. So we are going to see about two types of co-formulations, that is injectable co-formulation, which I'm going to concentrate more here, and the oral co-formulations, which I'm going to touch upon. As you know, insulin has a limitless capacity to reduce HbA1c than any other agent available to control diabetes. And over a period of time, like our presidential oration mentioned, actually from 1921, there has been a steady progress in the development of insulin. And in the last two decades, there has been a lot of improvement and introduction of newer insulins, which are both longer acting and ultra long acting insulins. And at present, we have a combination of insulin that is, if we combine, short-acting insulin with a long-acting insulin given twice daily, can last for about 12 to 24 hours. Degludec, which was introduced in 2014, had an ultra-long-acting potency. Its duration of action is about 42 hours. And as the beta cell function decline, we have to start insulin at some point, and also optimize or intensify insulin regime as the disease progresses. ADA has recommended that we can use premix insulin for intensification purposes when the oral drugs or the basal insulin fail. We can also use 3 times daily premix insulin to and it is found to be non-inferior to the basal bolus regime used. The currently available long-acting insulin, glargine and detemir, because of their solubility, cannot be co-formulated with the commercially available rapid-acting analog. So the insulin which was introduced about 4 years back, insulin deglutec, can be mixed with insulin aspart. And they form, you know, eczema, diexemers and eczemers as a combined solution. And when injected into the subcutaneous tissue, degludec forms poly eczemas, and which dissociates very slowly. And insulin aspart is rapidly dissociated, and the property pharmacokinetic of both the insulins are preserved when they are mixed together. And what is the difference between insulin degludec aspart and different form of premix insulins? See, when you have a premix insulin, you have to resuspend them before use. Otherwise, the only one insulin may go into a subcutaneous tissue and the pharmacokinetic may differ. But for insulin deglutec aspart, you don't need to have a resuspension, and it can be readily given, and the property of pharmacokinetic and pharmacodynamic of each insulin are preserved even if they are not resuspended. In the pharmacokinetic study, the glucose infusion, you can see a pattern of shoulder effect in patients with biphasic insulin aspart, where it can cause hypoglycemia and undesirable side effects. But clinically, when the degludec aspart was studied against glargine in about 300 patients, it was found that it is non-inferior to glargine in the HbA1c reduction. The fasting glucose reduction was slightly better with glargine, but the nocturnal confirmed hypoglycemia and overall confirmed hypoglycemia are much less with the insulin degludec aspart group. So superior glycemic control and effective fasting and postprandial blood sugar control can be seen with insulin degludec aspart, with more patients achieving HbA1c of less than 7 without hypoglycemia, and trend towards a lower risk of hypoglycemia is also seen. It was also studied with biphasic insulin aspart twice daily. There was about 450 patients studied, and the HbA1c reduction was good with both of them, but the fasting blood sugar control was better with the newer insulin, with the less hypoglycemia, nocturnal hypoglycemia and confirmed hypoglycemia. Especially if you could see the nocturnal confirmed hypoglycemia was much less with insulin degludec aspart as compared to the biphasic insulin aspart. So superior basal profile resulting in better fasting blood sugar control, lower risk of both overall and nocturnal hypoglycemia, lesser insulin dose and lower weight gain, does not require resuspension, and it is a clear solution and flexible and convenient to use in patients. The disadvantages are, as it is a ultra long acting insulin, lasts for more than 42 hours, day-to-day variation or adjustments cannot be done with these new insulin. A single dose ratio is only available 30/70 and may not be suitable for all individuals, and it cannot individualize the insulin treatment in these patients. The next co-formulation, before I go to the next injectable co-formulation, I want to go through a short history. It is about a patient who I have come across last week. It's a 47-year-old man who was having type 2 diabetes, who was weighing about 90 kilograms, BMI of 32, blood pressure of 130/80, on metformin, glimepiride, and dapagliflozin. He was started on insulin, but he was not able to continue because of hypoglycemia, has osmotic symptoms, and his fasting blood sugar of 286 and HbA1c of 11.4. where the renal parameters normal and the ketones were negative. So what is the best option available here? As the debater said, what is the first injectable medication? Can we combine both of them? That is GLP-1 analog and basal insulin, and what is the evidence? The combination formula is available, co-formulation of basal insulin and GLP-1 analog is available, that is Idecalira, and Iglalixi, even though it is not available in India, is also will be available in the market soon. So how does the complementary action help to control the blood sugar of basal insulin and GLP-1 analog? So hepatic glucose production is high in patients with type 2 diabetes, which is looked after by the basal insulin, and the beta cell and alpha cell dysfunction, which occurs in type 2 diabetes, is looked after by the GLP-1 analog. Thereby, the optimal HbA1c reduction occurs. If you look separately, GLP-1 analog, there is good HbA1c reduction, fasting blood, postprandial blood sugar, weight, there is a weight reduction, less hypoglycemia and nausea. If you do give basal insulin, there is reduction in HbA1c, fasting blood sugar, but there is an increase in weight gain and hypoglycemia. If you combine both of them, there is they act a complementary way to reduce the blood sugar, but there is weight reduction and the hypoglycemic risk also is less. There is also less nausea associated with GLP-1 analog. So what is available now? Insulin degludec, liraglutide as a combination, Ziltafi is available now in the market, and it is approved by the regulatory authorities in India. So the combination is available as a 3 ml pre-filled pen, fixed dose insulin degludec of 100 units per ml and liraglutide of 3.6 milligram per ml. If you give one dose step, it is called one dose step. If it is one unit of insulin degludec and 0.036 milligrams of liraglutide. They recommend to start on 10 dose steps, that is 10 units of insulin degludec and 0.36 milligram of liraglutide. The total dose would be, like, if you give 50 dose step of the maximum dose you can give with this pen as 50 dose step, that is 50 units of insulin degludec and 1.8 milligrams of liraglutide. What are the clinical evidence? There are dual 1, 2, 3, up to 6 is available, which was compared with OAD failure, compared with the basal insulin, compared with liraglutide alone, and throughout the HbA1c reduction was significant, and most of the patients achieved a HbA1c of less than 7. And the change in HbA1c was noted between 1.3 to 1.9 percentage when they were switched from basal insulin. There was a reduction of 1.9% reduction of HbA1c. The change of weight was also significant in patients who were switched from basal insulin to a combination of insulin degludec and liraglutide. The hypoglycemia events with subjects also less as compared to basal insulin and OADs, but it was a little high compared to GLP-1 switch. So the dual trials shows that insulin degludec liraglutide offers a better HbA1c reduction with weight reduction and lower rates of hypoglycemia as an add-on therapy to OAD and switch from GLP-1 and basal insulin. So the unmet needs of subjects with type 2 diabetes, uncontrolled with basal insulin, that is most of them having basal insulin and not controlled with that alone, hypoglycemia being a barrier in achieving a target HbA1c, weight gain being a barrier in achieving a target HbA1c, complex insulin regime or a barrier in achieving HbA1c reduction to target level, all met with this combination therapy. Significant HbA1c reduction, low rate of hyperglycemia, 2.7 kilogram weight loss from baseline, and once daily dosing. Insulin glargine-exenatide was also available as a co-formulation, and the studies shows that Lixlan-O, Lixlan-L compared with lixexanetide and glargine, found to have a superior reduction in HbA1c comparing to the individual molecules of lixexanetide and insulin glargine. So, but this product is not currently approved in India. So summary for injectables is in insulin experienced patient, type 2 diabetes patients, if you want to provide effective glycemic control, it has been found to be superior to the biphasic insulin aspart. And insulin degludec aspart twice daily is a simple way of, is a simple alternative to basal bolus treatment in the treatment of intensification of type 2 diabetes. And insulin degludec aspart would also be a suitable option over glargine for initiation with the largest meal in patients with type 2 diabetes. Insulin degludec lira and glargine glarlixi are promising in addressing the unmet needs of type 2 diabetes, that is weight gain and hypoglycemia with a good glycemic control. So I'm going to go through a couple of oral co-formulations. We are having a lot of fixed dose combinations available in the market to treat type 2 diabetes. We are very familiar. There are double drug combination, triple drug combinations are available in India. The advantages are increases the compliance, improves adherence, and reduces the pill burden in patients. The disadvantages are that you cannot titrate the individual drug in a possible way, and the incidence of adverse effects may be high and difficult to identify which medicine cause adverse effect if you are using a fixed drug combination. The cost of medication may go up if the unnecessary molecule is included in the fixed drug combination. Now they are coming with B12 supplementation in addition, or vitamin D supplementation, which are all unnecessary combinations. But one recent combination is DPP-4 inhibitor, like my previous speaker mentioned. DPP-4 inhibitor and SGLT2 inhibitor, or it's a rational combination to treat diabetes. Both agents target diverse physiology of in type 2 diabetes. Both agents are suitable in Indian phenotype. Glucagon rise in SGLT2 inhibitor may be countered by DPP-4 inhibitor. So they also have a synergistic effect through GLP-1, which both of them increase. Possible synergistic improvement with beta cell function, and both agents have low risk of hypoglycemia, and both agents do not cause much weight gain. Differenzo's theory of omnious octet, which mainly involves decreased insulin secretion, increased glucagon secretion, and increased glucose reabsorption from the kidneys, were all addressed with the combination of DPP-4 inhibitor and SGLT2 inhibitor. They both are addressed and can be in a complementary fashion, decrease the blood sugar. That is, DPP-4 is an insulin dependent mechanism, and SGLT2 is an insulin independent mechanism. Glucagon is increased by SGLT2, which is decreased by DPP-4 inhibitors. Both are weight neutral, have a low risk of hypoglycemia, and both reduces fasting and postprandial blood sugar in an effective way. US FDA has approved product in 2015 to improve the glycemic control as an adjuvant to diet and exercise. And it has been, it has undergone the phase 3 trial of efficacy and safety. Empagliflozin and linagliptin in different proportions were studied with the EMPA different doses and linagliptin 5 milligram. Study duration was about 52 weeks, and it involved about 700 participants. It showed in 24 weeks the HbA1c reduction was significantly more in patients who were using EMPA 25 and linagliptin 5. EMPA 10 and linagliptin were slightly lower, but EMPA 25, 10 and linagliptin had a little less HbA1c reduction comparing to the combination of both. More patients also achieved target HbA1c of less than 7 at 24 weeks when the two medications were combined together. Looking at the safety profile, you could see that the urinary tract infection and genital infections were less, very less in patients who were using a combination of SGLT2 inhibitor and DPP-4 inhibitor comparing to the medications which were used alone. The reasons were not clearly understood. So coming to the summary, targeting multiple pathophysiological mechanism of type 2 diabetes, rational way to manage type 2 diabetes, combination of DPP-4 inhibitor and SGLT2 inhibitor offers a novel, promising and safe avenue. Combination of empagliflozin and linagliptin substantiate the theory of long-term evidence awaited. All combination may not work. It may work for some patient, it may not work for some other patient. So individualization is necessary. So all the medications which I mentioned are very costly, and it reiterates that health is wealth. You can earn wealth also if you are healthy. You have to prevent diabetes by changing your lifestyle. Thank you.